Edith, Marsha Cochran's the best comic actress in the country. She's got an incredible sense of humour.
I thought her idea of a great gag was to break into a home for the blind and flatten out the braille.
Well, maybe she is a pain in the veritable, but you've got to admit she's still box office.
So, why did you close in Torquay?
You could stage the resurrection in Torquay and still lose a packet. That's one location this production passes by, I can promise you.
If it ever gets off the ground, is there any chance of having a mitre in here? Or does the great man only emerge from his tomb in total darkness?
There. That better? By the way, Miss Clavers, when Rom does put in an appearance, I'd advise you to engage brain before mouth. He's not the easiest person to get along with, and I'm sure you've heard of him. Don't make the mistake of thinking your physical attributes will make up for lack of intelligence in performance. Anything less than perfection starts Rom foaming at the mouth. Even the fabled Miss Monk found that out at a cost.
Not Mabel Monk, the American. You're not telling me she appeared in a horror film, are you?
Oh, no, no, not a horror film, of course not. It was back at Stratford in 1960. She'd just finished making a film over here, and the powers that be decided it would be great publicity to team up the world's greatest sex symbol with Britain's biggest box office draw. It was a total disaster. She was 3 months pregnant at the time, although nobody knew it but her. What with drink, drugs, and chronic depression, Rom simply took her apart. She gave two of the worst performances ever seen at Stratford, then had a nervous breakdown halfway through the third night and dropped out. It was the last time she ever worked.
Not exactly true. When she went back to the States, she spent the next 6 months in a private nursing home, having her brain unscrambled. Then Fox made the mistake of re-signing her for the make of Blood and Sound. 5 weeks into filming, she cracked up again and killed herself. Postnatal depression, I believe they called it. Of course, the publicity that followed did wonders for her reputation. To hear the media go on about her now, you'd think she'd practically invent Hollywood. Personally, I could never see the attraction. Oh, excuse me. There's someone arriving.
Slotty bitch.
Oh, you mustn't mind Edith. She can be a bit abrasive at initial meetings, but she's harmless enough. Wonder who the new arrival is. Can't be our leading lady. She's never been on time for anything in her life. No, definitely not Tanya. Not her style at all.
Have you met her?
She's replacing Philippa Jordan as Lady Millicent. Only fixed it up yesterday. They've extended Philippa's run in New York until September.
Lucky Philippa. Who else is coming? The entire company?
Oh, no, no. Just a select few, according to Edith. Ron's never been the one for playing the gracious host. In fact, I was quite surprised when he invited us all down here. There aren't many conclaims who've set foot in a place since he moved in. It's like a damn fortress.
Is he all there, do you think? I mean, all this? It's crazy. It's like something out of one of his films.
Oh, it is. The exterior is an exact copy of the one they knocked up for the House of Usher, hence the name. It was just an old ruin when Rom found it last year, but it took his fancy, so he had it done up the way it is now. Cost him an absolute packet, I hear, but it's what he wanted. The King of Horrors, House of Nightmares.
Nightmares, right? See the room they put me in? Overlooking a graveyard, for God's sake.
Not a real one, though. Last used in Revenge of the Ghoul, if memory serves me right. Courtesy of Pinewood Studios.
It's really enough to me. It's absolutely sick. First thing I did was to close the curtains. I can do very well without seeing that every time I walk into the room.
Darling, darling. Lovely to see you again. How's Angela? Still living together, or have you been a good boy and made an honest woman of her?
Hello, Brad. I didn't expect to see you here. I thought you were still in Paris.
Oh, don't remind me, darling. Utter disaster. 2 days after we arrived, the little queen ran off with a kitchen porter and my Rolex Oyster. My darling. Oh, don't tell me you're Dougie's new popsy. Don't say I've gone and put my foot in it again. Bradford Kyle, star of stage, screen, and you name it.
Hello, I'm Caroline
Clavers.
I'm playing Zoe.
Bit of a coincidence you being here, isn't it? Actually, I was coming in to see you on Monday, but I thought I'd drop in on Ron first. I heard you're looking for someone to play Rudolph, or whatever his name is, in the new play. So, of course, I dropped everything and caught the first plane back. You've not cast it yet, have you?
As a matter of fact, no. We're seeing people on Monday and Wednesday.
Cancel them, darling. Your Rudolph stands before you in all his pristine what's. I know it's not believed, but then the chance of working with Ron again, and in his first stage play for years when you know me, I walk starkers down Regent Street for a chance like that. Can I have it?
It's not quite as simple as that, Brad. Perhaps you'd better come and see me in the office and ask your agent to make an appointment.
Oh, let's leave George out of this. We can fix it up for ourselves. Old pals, eh? Why pay commission when you can arrange things for yourself? Oh, by the way, you don't have a copy of the script, have you, so I can run the old papers over it before the read-through.
I'm afraid not. Look, Brad, I don't think this is a good time for talking. We're down here at Ron's invitation, and you know what he's like for his privacy.
Oh, you don't need to worry about Ron. He'll be delighted to see me. Didn't I share billing with him in Spawn of the Zombie Queen?
No one shares billing with Ron.
Edith!
What are you doing here?
Edith, darling. Lovely to see you again. Missed your friendly face.
Question. How did you get past the gate? I gave strict instructions that no one was to be admitted unless their name was on the guest list. Yours was conspicuously absent.
Well, of course it was, darling. I didn't know I was coming myself till this afternoon. When I pulled up in a jolly old motor car, the fellow asked me if I was Mr. Bostock, so I said I was. He let me in without a murmur.
Oh, you had no right to do any such thing. Now I suggest you clamber back into your jolly old motor car and leave here at once. And the next time you want to gatecrash a private gathering, I would be pleased if you came in through the front door and not go sneaking in round the back. Is that clear? Excuse me. Hello? Oh, yes, let him through. No, the other man was an imposter. No, he'll be leaving in a few minutes. No, don't worry, it was not your fault. Mr. Kyle is an expert deceiver. Freddy Bostock's arrived. I'll see you to your car.
Oh, come, Edith, you can't chuck me out before I've had the grand guided tour. I've been dying to see this place ever since he bought it and never had the chance.
Some other time. For the moment.
What is this? Why this sudden hurry to be rid of me? I'm one of Ron's friends, for God's sake.
If Ron had wanted you here, he would have invited you. Now please, leave.
Well, I'm sorry to disappoint you, darling. But I'm not taking one step until Ron himself asks me to go. Understand?
Very well. That's your attitude. But don't say you weren't warned.
Did I detect a whiff of sulfur as the lady made her exit?
Well, the trouble with Edith is she thinks she's the zombie queen herself. How I would love to see her go up in the sacred flames. So, you're playing Zoe, are you? And what do you think of the script? Good, is it?
Fantastic. Another mousetrap.
It's a typical Romney Marsh vehicle. Not too much for anyone else, but I have a fairly good suicide scene in Act Two. To be honest, though, I can't see why he wants to do it. He's playing Solomon, that's the antique dealer. He has fewer lines than I have, it just doesn't make sense.
Well, I shouldn't worry about that. We're not in rehearsal yet. By the time Ron's finished, we'll be lucky to have a dozen lines each. You wouldn't believe the changes he made to the bell ringer on his last tour. Even the writer couldn't recognise it.
Well, I hope he doesn't start cutting my lines. I'm not some two-bit rep actress, you know.
Well, I think you should tell him that, darling. He does tend to go overboard when he's in a creative mood. As for myself, well, I'm content to pick up the crumbs he scatters when he finishes the meal. Speaking of meals, you've not eaten yet, have you? I'm absolutely starving.
I expect there will be dinner when the rest arrive, but I wouldn't be count on being included in it if I were. Look, Brad, why don't you slip away now before Ron comes down? I'll tell him about the part, I promise, if he knows you're interested.
That's all right, Ducky. I'll speak to Ron myself. We do go back a long way, you know.
Ah, Freddy, come in. Caroline Clavers, who's playing Zoe, and,
Bradford, Kyle. I'd recognise you anyway, Mr. Kyle. I saw you in to Harvest 5 times.
Did you? Not one of my greatest roles, but it paid well. Speaking of roles, of course, I'm a lot more choosy about roles these days. That's why I'm so anxious to play Rudolph. Now, you do see me as Rudolph, don't you?
Rudolph? Oh, yes. Rupert, actually. Rupert Collison. Well, I don't know. I mean, if Mr. Dekker thinks it's right, then it's fine by me. An actor of your standing, it'd be marvellous, yes.
I knew you'd agree. You see, straight from the horse's mouth.
Can I get you a drink, Freddy?
I wouldn't say no to a cup of tea. I have other things since I left London.
I wouldn't mind a cup of tea myself. Keep our brilliant young author company, eh? Oh, no, don't ring. I'll go myself. Give me a chance to have a quick snoop around before Edith sets the dogs loose on me.
Dogs? What dogs?
Oh, haven't you seen them, darling? They're in cages round the back. Slavering grey Dobermans with very unattractive teeth. Absolutely dozens of them.
You won't have them in the house, will he? I'm not afraid of dogs.
I don't think there's much chance of that. Ron's not very keen on dogs himself. Can't think why he'd be keeping Dobermans.
Oh, he isn't. They belong to Edith. She's keeping them and training them to rip unwanted guests apart. I get that too.
Sorry about that. He's a good actor, but he does tend to overstep the boundaries from time to time. He'd be totally unsuitable for the part of Rupert, and Ron won't hear of it, I can promise you.
Certainly seemed different off stage, not a bit like I imagined he'd be.
Well, you live and learn.
Don't let the act fool you. There's more to Brad than meets the eye. But sit down, Freddy. Take the weight off your feet.
Thanks. Some places must have cost a fortune.
Yes.
I've not kept you, have I? I mean, I'm not the last.
Not at all. Still one more to arrive. The rest arrived about 15 minutes ago. Still upstairs, I think.
And Mr. Marsh, Romney, that is. Have you seen him yet?
Neither fang nor claw, and I'm getting rather cheesed off with all this waiting around. Yes, we know he's a big star, but let the mortals have private lives too. If it was so desperately important to have a read-through before rehearsals began, why couldn't we have it in London? My fiancé wasn't exactly pleased to have his weekend arrangements ruined because I had to come down here.
Yes, I apologise, it was short notice, but it is for the good of the play. I was a little concerned about the ending of Act One, and wants to try out a few ideas now instead of wasting valuable rehearsal time later. Something I agree with entirely.
It's nothing dreadful, isn't it? I mean, I tried to keep it as tight as I could.
No. As far as I know, it's all very minor, but if we get it sorted out now, we've got a huge hit on our hands.
First time I've come across anything like this in a professional theatre.
Well, it's the way Ron likes to work, so we have to indulge him, don't we?
Hello, darlings. So this is where you're hiding yourselves, is it?
Lynda! We want the monks keeping you, and now we know.
Do you like it? Tell the truth now.
You look marvellous.
Designed it for Carl and Michaels, but I liked it so much I decided to keep it for my very own. Well, aren't you going to introduce us, Dougie, or do we have to do it ourselves?
Oh, yes, sorry. Caroline Clavers, Freddy Bostock, meet Lynda Molloy, my favourite designer.
Liar. Weren't you Virginia thing in that hysterical sitcom, Bright as a Button?
Yes, Virginia Dawson. They're doing another series later in the year, but I'm not sure I'll be back with them yet. You know, the usual argument over money, of course, but not to mention the billing.
Oh, I know. It's a constant fight for recognition, isn't it? I still have the same problem myself. No one wants to pay a fraction of what you're really worth, including certain theatrical managers standing not 200 miles away from here.
Pardon? Pardon?
I love the play, Freddy. I can call you that, can't I?
Please.
I've got the designs up in my room. I'll bring them down later and we can go through them. What ever gave you the idea for it? The play, I mean. It could have been written for Ron.
Well, it was, actually. I think I've seen every film he's ever made. So I've been able to use all his speech patterns and mannerisms in the character of Solomon's.
That last scene will have them on the edge of their seats. It's a marvellous twist, totally unexpected.
Where's Stella? Not feeling shy, is she?
Oh, no, she'll be down in a moment. She's just putting a few finishing touches to her makeup. When she walks through that door, she's going to make you jump out of your skins.
I don't think I like the sound of that.
Oh, it's nothing too frightful. Just a little idea I had, and I wanted to see your reactions.
Who's Stella? Or am I being stupid?
Stella Baker. She's playing the part of Cassandra. Can I get you a drink, Lynda? I'm just going to help myself to another.
Oh, divine man. I'll have a whiskey, please.
Caroline?
Thought you'd never ask.
Has anyone seen Ron yet? I was hoping to go through the set designs before we sat down to dinner. But Edith says he can't be disturbed unless the sky falls down.
And fall it shall, dears, if I don't get a bloody drink within the next 2 seconds.
Sonia!
Darling.
So you finally arrived?
Stop the pleasantries, precious, and fill me a drink. No need to stand, dear. Just treat me like you would any other international star. What a journey. Remind me never to buy a house in the country. Dracula's castle, more like it, complete with moat, drawbridge, and fake piranha fish.
Not fake, Tiger. The real thing?
You're joking. He's joking, isn't he? You're joking.
Afraid not. According to Edith, there's at least 200 of them swimming around down there. Harrods had them flown in especially.
He's gone mad. Flipped his head completely. What piranha fish in darkest England? What does he feed them on? Door-to-door salesman?
Out of work actors. We'd all better be especially nice to him this weekend, and otherwise we'll all be down there practicing our breaststroke.
Oh, shut up, lad. They didn't tell me you were in this ghastly thing.
Well, not yet, darling, but I'm working at it. Oh, and this is the author, by the way, Freddy Bostock.
Ouch. Only joking, darling. It's a lovely play, really. So, this is Usher. I must say the room seems spacious enough, but I'm not sure I approve of all the paintings. There's something obscene about having one's own image peering down at you when you're trying to relax. Oh, I suppose I could live with that one then. It was one of his better roles.
My God!
Hello, baby.
What the hell do you think you're playing at?
What is it? What's wrong?
Is this your idea of a joke? Coming in here like that, have you no sense at all?
What's my gun? What's wrong?
It's absolutely crazy. Big Rom had been here.
I don't understand.
Don't understand?
Of course she doesn't. How could she? She was only a kid at the time. Rom and Mabel didn't exactly hit it off, sweetie. There are those who say she'd never have killed herself if she hadn't had the misfortune of working with Rom. Now does the dawn start to break?
Oh, God. No wonder you all looked as though you'd been told. I'd no idea. Quick, back upstairs and get into your own things and don't let anyone see you.
I brought the tea. Would you like me to pour or will you help yourselves?
We'll help ourselves. Thanks.
Are you all right, Tanya? You're white as a sheet.
I'm fine, fine. It was just the shock seeing her standing there.
I had no idea. Honestly, I hadn't. I mean, you all know how much I idolise Mabel. When I read the script, I thought the part of Cassandra cried out for Mabel Monk. And as Stella faintly resembled her, I came up with that outfit. I thought you'd be ecstatic.
You sure you haven't a touch of Mrs. Danvers running through your veins, darling?
The mad housekeeper in Rebecca. It's a Daphne du Maurier thing. She pulls the same kind of stunt on the new wife. Gets her to dress up in the dead one's clothes. Scares the life out of hubby and co.
Oh, yes, I think I saw the film once.
Look, I'd appreciate it if we kept this to ourselves. Don't blame Stella. She was only doing what I asked her to. I'll apologise to her, of course.
I think I owe her an apology too. It was just such a shock to see her standing there, as if she'd just stepped off the set.
Funny, isn't it? That's the second time in 15 minutes Mabel Monk's name cropped up. We were talking about her just before you came in.
Oh?
In that case, you'd better mention her a third time, darlings, and get it out of your system. The name's taboo and farewell if Ron's in the vicinity.
But what happened? I mean, she seemed nice enough to me.
You met her?
Well, fleetingly. I was only a schoolgirl at the time, and she was over here filming Hello Baby at Bray Studios. I spotted her in the foyer of the Savoy Hotel signing autographs, and naturally I wanted one as well, but I didn't have my book with me. She took a snapshot out of her evening bag and signed the back of that. I treasured it for years. You can imagine how devastated I was when she died.
You wouldn't be so devastated if you had to work with her. She was the most self-centered, oversexed little trollop I've ever come across. And believe me, I've been around a long time.
I know, darling.
You did the cabaret at the last supper, didn't you?
I did Hello Baby with her, and that was an experience in the world. As long as it wore trousers, nothing was safe. Isn't that right, Dougie? And age was no barrier. She'd sleep with anything from 8 to 80.
Let's change the subject, shall we? We've much more important things to discuss right now. That all ended 30 years ago.
Did it? I wonder.
Anyone protects? I've always wanted to say that line in a play, haven't you? Conjures up such a lovely image. An English weekend in high summer. Birds twittering. Strawberry jam. Buttered scones, and the exhilarating thwack of a tennis ball on stretched strings. And what do we get? Billowing fog.
Oh, my God, he's right. Look at things.
But that's ridiculous. The forecast has never said anything about fog.
Well, there it is, dearie. Thicker than pea soup and simply rolling in.
At least we got here before it came down.
Yes, and it's just in time to ensure that little me will have to stay for dinner. They wouldn't dare toss me out in this lot. What can be keeping Rod?
If you care to follow me to the dining room, we'll be eating in a few minutes.
I can't sit still. Will Rod be joining us tonight, Edith? I must say I'm rather surprised he hasn't seen fit to welcome any of his guests this evening, particularly me.
Don't worry, Tanya. I'm very sorry, but Ron's been so busy, there's been such a lot to do this afternoon. But don't worry, he'll be at his usual place at table. Now, if you wouldn't mind.
Thank you.
house. This is Mr. Marsh. The last of my guests have arrived, and no one else is expected. You have precisely 5 minutes to leave the grounds before the security fences are charged, and I shall expect to see you Monday morning sharp, together with the dog handlers, as we discussed. In the interest of your own safety, I would urge you not to forget them. Have a pleasant weekend.
Caught like rats in a trap.
And then when the door opens, Cassandra's body is seen only by Rupert. Do you understand what I mean?
So we lose Zoe's line. My God, she's been murdered, plus the rest of that page, and pick up on Rupert's line, in Solomon's what we're going to see now, etc.
Exactly.
Well, what about my line? The one about her being the second one to die? If I haven't seen her, how can I say it? It wouldn't make sense.
And then the solution should be obvious, Miss Clavers. But you don't say the line.
But it's my last one, Maxine. If we're cutting that in a whole chunk after it, it may as well not be there at all.
Oh. Do we take it then that you don't intend to act for the rest of the scene?
Well, of course I shall, but I'd like something to act with. I don't want to be left standing there like a spare part.
But that's exactly what you are, my dear. A spare part. Unless I'm very much mistaken, the writer of the script, a Mr. Bostock, intended the character of Solomon's to be the central one. I, Miss Clavers, am playing Solomon's, and you... And again, correct me if I'm wrong, have been engaged to play a minor role. A role which, in view of your reading tonight, would seem to be far in excess of your meager talents. Don't you agree?
I beg your pardon.
No, no, my dear, it's not my pardon you should be begging. It's the pardon of this young man here, who has taken a considerable amount of time to construct an excellent drama, only to see it mangled by a so-called actress, who would obviously have insurmountable difficulty making sense of a domestic shopping list.
How dare you speak to me like that? How dare you?
Oh, sit down, woman. Even your outrage lacks belief. Drama school indignation at its pathetic worst. I can't work with this creature, Douglas. Find a replacement.
Don't bother yourself. I can work with this repulsive old monster for an Oscar. And as for your information, Mr. High and Mighty Marsh, my upbringing was strictly kosher, and ham is something I can well live without.
Wrong.
It's all right. Don't apologize. Forget it. You saw for yourself. The woman can't even make a decent exit. Don't worry. We'll find a real actress to play Zoe. You. Stand up. It's possible, it's possible. There seems to be a vestige of brain inside that head of yours.
But she's already playing the part of Cassandra.
A nothing part. Find someone else for it. She plays Zoe. Can you learn it?
I think so.
I didn't ask you to think. I asked if you could learn it. Good. Then we'll run through the first scene tomorrow without books. Without books. There. You see how easy it is to solve the major problems? We now have our Zoe, and the minor problem of Cassandra will be solved early next week. Isn't that so, Douglas?
Yes, Ron.
Is something wrong?
Smart.
Then why are you still here? Do you learn your lines by thought transference, perchance? Actresses.
I'll go and have a word with Caroline.
No, wait. There's something I want to discuss with you. Both of you. Where's Tanya?
Up in her room, I expect.
Call her.
But it's 10:45.
If I wanted to know the time, I'd have looked at my watch.
Yes. Call her now.
You've made notes of all we discussed, Freddy?
I think. I mean, yes, sir. I've got them all, every last one.
Good. Then you'll have the new version for me after breakfast.
Rob would like to see you in the Lovecraft Room straight away. Thank you. She'll be right down.
Good. Now tell Mrs. Bales to come in here and clear up the mess. The place looks like a pigsty. No, wait. I need you here. Perhaps Mr. Bostock wouldn't mind.
No, of course not.
Sit down, both of you. I wish you hadn't done that one. Upset Caroline. She has signed a contract, and if she wants to make something of it, we could be in big trouble with equity.
Why should we be in trouble with equity? She walked out on us, remember? Quit, because we cut a few lines from her part. I failed to see how equity would take up her case in the face of four independent witnesses swearing to this.
It wasn't like that at all. You insulted her professional dignity.
Dignity, perhaps. Professional, never. Besides, I'm sure nobody here will have any recollection of such an event. Will they? Then there'll be no problem with that, I assure you.
But we do have a problem. I suppose that's what you want to discuss. Bradford Kyle.
On the contrary, there is no problem with Brad. If he wants the part, he shall have it. I know I can rely on him. Yes?
I've come for the thing, sir.
If you don't mind me saying so, I don't think Brad's the ideal choice for the part. In my opinion...
Well, I want your opinion, Edith. I'll give it to you. How many more times do I have to tell you that I make the final decisions in casting my shows?
I'm sorry, Rob, but I agree with Edith. Brad's a name. He commands a big salary, and the part of Rupert's hardly more than a jubilee. There are hundreds of actors who play the part for a fraction of what we have to pay Dick.
Hundreds of actors would also play the part of Solomon's for a fraction of my salary. But if you hired them, you wouldn't have me, would you? Now stop raising stupid objections and arrange for his contract.
You wanted to see me?
Close the door. And sit down. Am I supposed to tremble in my shoes, calling the police to protect me? Barricade myself behind my own doors? Is that what I'm supposed to do, eh? Well, why doesn't someone answer me?
If we knew what this was about, it might make it a little easier.
Do you take me for a fool? Did you think I had no idea that one of you was responsible?
Responsible for what?
Responsible for these!
What are they?
Press cuttings. On Mabel Monk.
Or more specifically, on the suicide of Mabel Monk.
Listen. Where did you get these?
I received them in the mail. The first one Monday last and the final one this morning. Isn't that obvious? Can't you see the messages scrawled across them?
5 days, 4 days, 3 days, 2 days, tomorrow.
No. Sounds like a warning.
Of course it's a warning! But a warning of what?
Obviously something to do with Mabel Monk, would you say?
And why should that concern me? The bitch has been dead 30 years.
Have you told the police about these?
That someone is sending me ancient press cuttings. There's no need to bring the police into this. No. I shall find the person responsible myself and make my own arrangements for dealing with them. No one, but no one, attempts to frighten Romney Marsh.
Just a minute. I can see why you might suspect one of us of having sent those things to you. We all at one time or another had the misfortune to come into contact with Darling Lady. But why would we want to do anything like that? None of us could stand her. It wouldn't make sense.
She's right.
However, I do have an idea who may have sent them.
Really?
Oh, it's possible I could be wrong, though I very much doubt it. But just for the minute, let's say it's someone who may blame you for the way she killed herself and is trying to get back at you.
After 30 years? Don't be ridiculous. And besides, how can I be responsible for some oversexed tarts driving her car over a cliff 8,000 miles from here?
Oh, I didn't say you were, darling. But there were mutterings at the time that you caused her death.
No. Absolute nonsense. It had nothing to do with Rom. The woman was incapable of giving a credible performance. Every critic in the country slated her, Portia.
You don't have to convince me, Edith. As far as I was concerned, the only performances that little cow could manage were the ones that took place in her bedroom. But the person I'm thinking of could believe otherwise and have some idiotic thought of revenge in mind. Did any of you know she was English?
English? But her parents were American. Hollywood film extras. Everyone knows that.
I got to know her quite well during the time we were making Hello Baby. She told me herself she was actually born here and taken to America when her real parents separated. The woman everyone assumed was her mother was in fact her father's common-law wife. A divorcee with a two-year-old daughter of her own. The two of them were brought up as sisters.
I assume there's some point to all this.
When she came over here in 59 to make the film, her real mother crawled out of the woodwork. I used to see her now and again hanging around outside the studios waiting for Mabel to finish. But of course I had no idea who she was at that time. I just assumed she was a fan. But one night, Mabel introduced us. There was also a younger sister she never knew she had. I met them a couple more times before we finished the film and got the full story.
But why hasn't all this come out before? The muckery could have dragged up everything she did from cradle to grave for the past 30 years. No one's ever hinted at this.
No, of course. Of course they haven't, but there's a very good reason. Her so-called parents separated when she was 17, and the stepmother left Hollywood to go back east, taking her own daughter with her. She died there in 1951, and no one knows what happened to the girl. Arthur Mount, the father, died of cancer sometime in 54, which meant, of course, there was no way anyone could discover the truth from him, either.
But what about her birth certificate? Surely that would have shown who her real parents were.
Well, of course it would if they could have found it. But by the time the investigations began, every scrap of information referring to her earlier life had gone, presumably destroyed. Monk was only a stage name. No one knew what her real name was. And for the life of me, I can't remember what the mother and sister called themselves.
Forgive me for being obtuse, but I fail to see what this has to do with those press cuttings.
Well, I've almost finished. As you must remember, just before she killed herself, she told someone at Fox Studios that her sister had arrived to take care of the baby. From all accounts, the woman never left the grounds and managed to keep pretty much out of sight. In fact, come the great day, she never even went to the funeral. While half of Hollywood turned out to cheer, she vanished into thin air, taking Mabel's baby with her. Even today, no one's any idea of where they went. It's just another Hollywood legend. I swore I wouldn't reveal this to a living soul. Well, not till I've published my autobiography. But I'm damn sure I know what actually happened over there.
We're all agog.
Don't you see? For the last 30 years, they've been looking for the wrong person. her real mother when we were making Hello Baby. She must have invited one or both of them over to Hollywood during the time she spent in the clinic. They were actually there when the child was born. When she killed herself, they simply took the baby and whatever jewelry and cash they could lay their hands on and came back to England.
So what you're saying is that the person who sent these press cuttings to Ron could have been Mabel's mother or sister.
Or baby.
Oh, surely that's being a little fanciful, Tavia. Sounds like one of those far-fetched plots dreamed up by the authors of American soap operas.
Doesn't it? But if you'll give me a couple of minutes, I think I'll be able to prove it to you.
What do you mean? Where are you going?
Hopefully to have a few words with the sender of those cuttings.
You mean one of them's here? In this house?
If they're not, then my eyes are playing tricks. But there's one way to find out, isn't there? And then perhaps we can see what all this is about.
If she's wasting my time...
No, she's serious. And if what she says is right, we may have stumbled on something more.
What's the matter? What is it?
Thought I heard something.
What kind of something?
I don't know, perhaps the other door closing, but the room's empty enough now.
You mean to say you think there might have been someone in there listening to us?
No, I must have imagined it. What was I saying?
Oh, am I interrupting something?
Well...
It's all right, I'll go away again. I just thought you may have finished when I saw Tommy going down the hall. Can I be a pest and help myself to a drop of scotch? It's not that I'm ever totally inebriate. I simply can't get to sleep at night unless I've had a drink or two. Preferably two.
By all means, help yourself.
I just love the house room and the divine conservatory. I didn't know you waited for exotics. The perfumes are enough to knock you out. Excuse me, I'm for Miss Mason. She was asking for Miss Bakewell.
Did she say why?
No, sir. She just asked if I'd seen her. But I hadn't, until now, that is, when I think I saw her running up the stairs.
Did you see from which direction she came, Mrs. Fales?
Oh, no, sir. It was just a glimpse as I came up the corridor.
I see. Thank you.
Will that be all for tonight, sir?
Unless anyone cares for fox milk or such like. Very well, you may retire, Mrs. Bales.
Thank you, sir. Good night.
Excuse me. Won't be a moment.
Edith, what do you know about this Bakewell girl?
What a lot. George Kay recommended her. She'd done some work in Birmingham and Leeds and Liverpool, a couple of small roles for the BBC. She read well, so Daddy gave her the part.
I want to investigate it. Find out exactly who she is and where she came from.
Can I be of any help?
Keep out of things that don't concern you. This is a personal matter.
Sorry I spoke, but I do know her rather well, and if you've any questions, you don't know. Maybe she can help Ron. How long have you known her?
Oh, about 9 years. I did some set designs for separate tables and still was playing Miss Tanner. We found we'd a lot in common and kept in touch. I stayed at her parents' place in Derby a couple of times. In fact, last year they asked me up to their silver wedding celebrations.
25 years? But the girl's older than that.
Well, they aren't her real parents. She's a foster child. Her mother had a drink problem and couldn't cope with her, so the Bakewells took her in. It was the best thing that could have happened to her. She absolutely adores them.
Love all the camper, Rom, but daubing Kensington gore on the banister rails does seem just a teens bit over the top.
What are you talking about?
This, dear heart, remains sticky stuff. Oh, I do hope Mrs. Thing won't mind rinsing it through for me. It's the only one I've got with me.
Let me see. This isn't stage blood. It's real.
But it's all down the stair rail.
Could someone have had a nosebleed or something?
Get the others. I want to see them here at once.
I'll go and look.
No! Nobody needs this.
all about. First of all, I'm threatened. Then my intelligence is insulted by stories of revenge for events that happened 30 years ago. Now blood is found smeared all over my house. I will not have this. Any of it! Sit down, both of you! Something is happening here that makes me very angry. Someone, for reasons best known to themselves, is trying to play games with me. However, I warn you, I am an excellent player of games and have made it a rule of my life never to lose. Never. They come here to my house, accept my hospitality, then try to make a fool of me, frighten me, have a good laugh at my expense. Well, I tell you this, all of you, Romney Marsh will have the last laugh.
Well,
sit there.
Well, thank you.
This is my house, and you will do as I tell you.
And what will you do if I don't? Toss me in the moat, or lock me in a dungeon? I presume there is a dungeon in this crackpot film set you call a house.
Now, listen.
And as for you, you pathetic excuse for a man, I disrespect you as an actor, but I've had my eyes opened here today. You're nothing more than another spy and sycophant who's so desperate for work, you'd accept any insult in exchange for a bit heart. Well, wait till I get back to London. I'm going to make sure this little escapade reaches the ears of every gossip columnist in the country.
Come in, sit there.
Jump to it, darling. We might lock you in the Iron Maiden.
What's happening happened? There's blood on the stairwell.
Another charming touch of Miss Marsh's, dear. It goes with the shrunken head to the door handles. And if you look closely enough, you'll probably find his bookmarks are human tongues torn out of the roots.
That is enough! One more word from you, Miss Clavers, and I warn you, you'll never work in the West End again. Not to mention half the red companies in Britain. And don't make the mistake of thinking I can't do it, because you'd be wrong, Miss Clavers. Very wrong.
Freddy Bostock will be down in a few moments. I can't seem to find Tanya.
Have you seen her?
Not since the read-through.
But she came to your room.
No, why should she?
Where did you go when you left here 15 minutes ago?
Upstairs, to learn my line.
Without a script? This is yours, I believe?
Yes.
And then perhaps you'd care to explain.
After I left here, I was halfway up the stairs and I realised I'd left it behind. I was going to come back for it, but then I...
Yes?
For God's sake, Rom, stop making such a song and dance about it. She was scared stiff of you and thought if she came back, you'd bite her head off. So she dropped in and borrowed mine.
Is this true?
Yes.
I've not kept you, have I? I was in the shower. Is something wrong? Somebody hurt?
Why should they be?
Well, it's just that something looks like blood on the stairwell. I almost put my hand in it.
Have you seen Tanya?
A few minutes ago, yes. She was looking for Stella, but she wasn't in her room, so she came across to see if she was with me.
Well, why should she do that?
She thought we might be running over Zoe's lines together. But, of course, we weren't. I mean, I was about to step into the shower.
Did you see where she was going when she left?
Well, no, I only had a towel wrapped around me. Why? She's not missing, is she? I mean, she can't be far away.
Did you check the library?
Well, no, I assumed she'd be upstairs.
Do it now!
Shall I check this side of the house first?
I don't care. Just find her!
Do you think something's happened to her, dearie?
Why should it have? She was fine just a few moments ago.
Where did the blood come from? And how did it get on the stair rail?
Oh! Tanya! She's dead! She's lying in there with her throat cut!
But she can't be, there's only us in the house.
There must be some mistake.
Bet your life there's some mistake. Tanya's as dead as I am. This is something they've cooked up between them, a little entertainment for the weekend. Any minute now she's going to come swanning through that door shouting, "Georgia, darling!" and laughing her silly little head off because you all fell for it.
Xavier. She's been murdered.
What?
Through there, Edith's just found her.
Excuse me, I don't feel very well.
No, nobody leaves this room.
Sorry.
Come back!
No, let them go from. We have to talk.
Talk? What could we talk to? Don't you understand what this means? A murder has been committed in my house. The house of Romney Marsh. I could be finished.
What is happy to do with you, Rob? They can't hold you responsible for this. You have two independent witnesses who swear you never left the room.
Well, that's all very well, dear heart, but where does it leave the rest of us?
I'm afraid that's your problem. All I know is Rob and I are totally in the clear.
Why should any of us want to kill him?
I've never met her before in my life. And we've been married for years.
Same here.
That may be so. All I know is, whoever killed Tanya, it couldn't possibly have been the two of us.
Has anyone called the police?
Rob thought we ought to give ourselves time to think of it.
I'll do it now. The sooner we get them there here, the better.
No, wait! Wait! Don't you see? This has something to do with those newspaper cuttings. It's all tied in with them. It has to be.
Newspaper cuttings? What newspaper cuttings?
The one Rob's been receiving since last Monday. Contemporary accounts of Mabel Monk's suicide.
But why? I mean, that was all back in the 60s, wasn't it?
And why should that have anything to do with Tanya's murder?
Because, my dear Lynda, she thought she knew who'd been sending them. Someone here, in this house. One of you.
Well, I've sent lots of strange things through the post in the last week, but I don't seem to recall sending any newspaper cuttings.
No one's accusing you, Brad. But without excessive brain strain, I think we can easily deduce which one of you did. No. The sender of those press cuttings is the illegitimate daughter of Miss Mabel Monk, the oh-so-innocent-looking Miss Stella Bakewell.
What?
Just before Tanya was murdered, she told us she believed the missing child was brought back to this country and raised by its aunt as her own. She also believed that the grown-up child was here, in this house, and left the room fully intending to return with her, plus an explanation for those press cuttings. Both Mrs. Bales and Mr. Bostock have told us that Tanya was looking for Miss Bakewell. It therefore follows that Miss Bakewell is Mabel Mutt's daughter and Tanya Mason's murderer.
That's ridiculous. Stella's mother was a dipsomaniac and a Hollywood film star. Anyway, even if she was Mabel's daughter, why would she kill Tanya just to prevent her telling anyone? Besides, it's impossible for her to have done it. According to Mrs. Bales, Tanya asked her if she'd seen Stella, and being told no. A few moments later, according to Freddy, Tanya was upstairs looking for Stella. Isn't that right, Freddy?
Yes. She came to my room, as I told you.
And Mrs. Bales came looking for her here to say she thought she'd just seen Stella hurrying upstairs.
If there's some point to this rigmarole, Douglas, kindly make it. You're telling us nothing we don't already know.
Well, isn't it obvious? Stella couldn't possibly have had time to murder Tanya upstairs, carry her down here, put her in the room next door, and get back upstairs into her room before Evie arrived to tell her he wanted to see her.
And don't forget, she popped into my room to borrow my script.
So she killed her before she went upstairs.
No. If you remember, just before Lynda came in, I looked next door, and it was empty. And at that time, Tanya was still upstairs. Freddy was speaking to her.
Then?
Whoever killed Tanya must have been waiting for her down here, on this floor.
Would it come as a great surprise to you if I told you the telephone was out of order?
What?
I tried to dial 999, but I couldn't get it to the house. Dead.
Would you like me to try? I know a bit about them. Perhaps it's just a loose connection.
Be my guest, but for the waste of your time, I'm jumping into my car and heading for the nearest. I'm not spending another minute in this madman's house, and that's flat.
Now, I'm afraid your departure is quite out of the question, Miss Clavers. Like it or not, until Monday morning, you are a guest here in my house, and there is nothing either of us can do about it.
Is that so? Well, just watch me.
Then I hope you're fond of dogs, Miss Clavers, because there's 18 of them roaming the grounds at the present time, just waiting to sink their teeth into anyone foolish enough to venture outside.
Not those bloody Dobermans I saw out there.
I'm afraid so. I released them from their kennels just before dinner. Naturally, I wasn't expecting anyone to be murdered here this weekend. However, it was my intention to prevent anyone from leaving until I'd settled the little matter of those press cuttings. I followed the example of Dr. Vincent in my film Hounds of Hell and arranged for security people to deliver the animals yesterday. Unfortunately, although it seems my original suspicions were unfounded, the dogs will still serve their purpose. No one may possibly leave Usher until Monday morning when the dog handlers arrive. Should anyone set foot outside the house, there is every possibility it's the last thing they'll ever do.
I told you he was mad. Now will you believe me?
We can't spend all weekend trapped inside the house. Not with a murderer on the loose.
We have no other choice.
I'd better have a look at that phone. Maybe I can fix it.
I can't believe this is actually happening. It's like a situation from one of those damn horror films you've been appearing in for the last 25 years. Thick fog. Telephone out of order, savage dog roaming the grounds, body in the room next door. It's like some sort of bizarre practical joke.
Oh, some joke, sweetie, with Tanya's throat slit from ear to ear.
Don't. That girl, Caroline.
What about her?
Well, if Stella couldn't have killed Tanya, she did. She must have been listening through there. You remember, Dougie, you thought you heard somebody. Tanya left here. Caroline met her in the hall, killed her, left her body through there, and then went upstairs to her room. I thought she looked flushed when I went to fetch her, but I assumed she'd been crying.
But if Caroline's Mabel Monk's daughter, why would she kill Tanya? Tanya obviously thought Stella was the person she wanted. Well, why would she go looking for her?
But Tanya didn't say who. All she said was she thought she knew the identity of Mabel Monk's child. Caroline assumed she'd be recognized and killed Tanya to keep her quiet.
Well, I'm sure you're right, sweetie. You always are. But I'm just a teensy bit confused about the reason for all this. Why murder someone? Just to cover up the fact that you've been sending newspaper cuttings through the post. It's not exactly the strongest motive I've ever heard of.
Unless, of course, she had something similar planned for Rob.
Because I rejected her mother 30 years ago.
Don't you be ridiculous.
Rejected? What do you mean?
Exactly what I said. We were going to be married. I terminated the relationship during rehearsals at Stratford. We met in London when she was filming Hello Baby, and I was completing the case of Dr. Strange. Preferring to keep our interest in each other a closely guarded secret, we agreed not to make any announcement until the end of the Stratford season. In the circumstances, it was a wise decision. I discovered during rehearsals that she was expecting another man's child. I was left with no option but to withdraw my offer of marriage.
So that's what happened. That's why she went to pieces and couldn't learn her part. But how come nobody knew?
I am not in the habit of discussing my personal life, as you well know. And had this recent situation not arisen, the story would have gone to my grave with me.
Why,
Why couldn't you have told me?
For the simple reason that even those most loyal can let things slip in unguarded moments, reveal things they're not supposed to know. And
what is it?
What a fool I am. What a blind, unthinking idiot. We were wrong. All wrong. We were looking at the wrong person. She didn't know, did she? How could she have? She wasn't even here.
Who wasn't?
Told her, of course. She wasn't here when we...
Oh. Quick! He's choking!
Lying! Lying!
Wrong! Too late. He's dead.
Oh my God. Oh my God.
I can't see much possibility of them finding out which of us it was.
Well, from a managerial point of view, it's not a very satisfactory arrangement, is it? Would you employ thespians with possible murderous tendencies? I think not. We're going to be under suspicion for the rest of our lives.
That's idiotic. I didn't
care. And neither did I, dear heart. But how do we prove it? Playing detectives, you mean?
Why not? It's just better than just sitting around waiting to be rescued.
Well, all right, but I'll warn you, I'm not very good at it. What do we do first? Grill the suspects?
Actually, I've already made a start. I've been making a mental list of those who couldn't possibly have killed her. Edith, Mr. Marsh, Lynda.
Why couldn't she have done it?
Lynda? Well, because she couldn't have. I mean, I've known her for years. She couldn't kill anybody. And besides, she and Tanya were friends.
Well, Tanya and I were friends, but there have been times I could cheerfully have murdered her myself. She was no angel, you know. That woman was so devious. She could stab you in the back and you wouldn't realise you were dead till 20 years later. There's one poor zombie upstairs who still doesn't realise it, and...
What? What is it?
Oh, nothing. Just thinking aloud, that's all. That's, is that coffee I can smell? I'll see you again in a minute or two, and we'll talk about it some more. Oh, sorry.
Oh, my God, it's morning. I've had the most awful night. You can believe the dreams. Nothing but blood and dead bodies and people chasing each other up and down the corridors with knives in their hands.
Would you like some tea? My house is available to make you some.
Oh, I couldn't face it at this hour. It's not 6 o'clock yet. I haven't been up this early in years.
You feel like talking. Something I'd like to discuss about last night.
What about it?
About what happened. It hasn't heard up. There's something wrong.
In what way?
I don't think Mr. Marsh had a heart attack at all. I think he was murdered.
What?
The chocolate. The one you all thought he choked on. It was poisoned. I'm sure of it.
Oh, perhaps it wasn't poisoned. He had a heart attack. You all agreed.
I don't care what you agreed. Someone in this house poisoned him, and that someone was the same person that cut Tanya Mason's throat.
That's ridiculous. If anyone had wanted to murder Ron, they'd have come up with something more certain than a poisoned chocolate. How could they be sure he'd eat it? He might have offered them around, and then what? The wrong person would have died. No, it was a heart attack. It had to be.
There's nothing wrong with his heart. I asked Mrs. Bales a few minutes ago.
Well, how would she know? She's only been with him a few months. Edith's been worried about him for years. She said so. The trouble with Ron was he wouldn't have anything to do with doctors. Preferred to dose himself up with herbs and things.
But I don't care if he chewed rabbit droppings. In my opinion, he suddenly realised who the real murderer was, but already had chocolate in his mouth. He was trying to tell you, just before he said chocolate started choking. Don't you remember? He said he was looking at the wrong person for Tanya's killer.
Well, yes, he'd been looking at you, hadn't he? He thought you were Mabel's daughter because Tanya had gone looking for you. But we all know now it was because she'd seen you in that outfit I designed. The resemblance had been so extraordinary. I could hardly believe you weren't Mabel Monk myself.
All right, but you do agree. He suddenly realised who the real murderer was. Poison chocolate or no poison chocolate?
Oh, I don't know, Stella, I really don't. People say things. He was choking.
Not at that moment. You said so yourself. He said that Tanya wasn't here when, and then he started to choke. What was he going to say? Tanya wasn't here when what? And who did he mean was lying?
That's something we're never going to know, unless the police could manage to make sense of it all. I still can't take it in. One of us has actually committed murder, and probably brought on Ron's heart attack into the bargain. It's too incredible for words.
That's just what Brad said a few minutes ago. That's why I've got to try and do something before the police arrive.
So what do you suggest? We ask the murderer to own up and let the rest of us off the hook.
Of course not. We've got two options. Firstly, we try to find out who the real murderer is. Or secondly, if everybody agrees to it, we provide the police with a solution that will keep them happy.
And how do
How do we do that?
Tell the police that Ron killed her.
You're not serious, are you?
You can't accuse an innocent man of murder, even if he's dead.
And what about the real man? We'd be giving him the opportunity to walk away scot-free.
It's more than we'll ever do. Police never find out who it is.
I'm sorry. It's totally out of the question. And I think the others will back me up on that.
Well, that's that, isn't it? We just have to keep our fingers crossed. But all the same, I'm not going to sit around for the next 24 hours and do nothing. Like it or not, I'm going to try and get to the bottom of this.
She's made up her mind that Ron was murdered too, with a poisoned chocolate. I've told her she's wrong, but she won't listen. Do you think I should try again?
Might be an idea. We've got to last out until tomorrow morning, and the less we rock the boat, the better. If she asks the wrong person the wrong questions, well, they've already killed once.
I'll do it now.
Damn. Damn. Damn.
Something wrong.
Who pulled the stake out of your heart? It's not even 7 o'clock yet.
I've just been up to your room, wanting to have a quiet word alone.
Oh?
It's been some time since you and I last had a private little get-together, hasn't it, Daddy? Over 30 years, come to think of it.
What's that supposed to mean?
Now don't tell me you've forgotten. That divine little flat in Windsor. Your 23rd birthday party. All that lovely wine.
Brad?
Oh, don't worry, Dougie. I've not had a sudden urge to recreate the past. Your secret's safe with me.
What secret? Nothing happened.
Didn't it?
No, it didn't. And you damn well know it. I was stoned out of my mind.
Oh, that's true, Mart. Dead to the world. But then there were those rather candid photographs, weren't there? And the camera doesn't lie.
Doesn't it? It's fooled the public into taking you for a man for the last 29 years.
If I were a vindictive old queen, Dougie, which I'm not, I could be very hurt at that statement. As a matter of fact, I'm deeply ashamed of what happened that night. You didn't deserve it, and I'm sorry. But I don't expect you to believe it.
Is that supposed to make me feel better? Do you think that makes up for what I went through afterwards? I could have killed myself. I probably would have done it if it hadn't been for Tanya.
Oh, yes, sweet darling Tanya. Always there with a shoulder to cry on. She was very good to me too, you know. Got me my first job in show business. Did she ever tell you that?
Why should she? She knew how I felt about you. I could have killed you as soon as looking.
Was it you who killed her?
Don't be stupid. Why would I want to kill her?
Maybe because you've discovered that she had arranged to have those photographs taken.
What?
I was 17 at the time, desperate to get my equity card. There was a showbiz party one night at the Ivy, and I managed to gate crash. That's where I first met Tanya. Oh, she wasn't a star then, of course, so she was working at it. As a matter of fact, she was in the middle of shooting Hello Baby with the delectable Mabel Monk. Do you see where I'm leading? Go on. Tanya wasn't happy. In fact, she was downright miserable. She'd got this problem, you see. She'd fallen for a young clerk in the studio accounts office, one Douglas Dekker, Esquire. And just as she thought she'd landed him, down swooped the aforementioned Miss Monk like a hawk and carried him off in her dainty little claws.
That's ridiculous. There was nothing between Tanya and me at the time. We were just good friends.
Not according to Tanya. Well, naturally, she wasn't going to sit back and take that line down. And that's where I came in. She arranged that birthday dinner, as you know. And she made sure I got a personal invitation to attend. Mabel wasn't there, of course. They were doing some night filming. But she was coming along later. Tanya slipped something into your drink. Then when you passed out, arranged for a taxi to take you and me and the photographer back to your flat in Windsor for the photo session. The prints were delivered to Mabel's dressing room the following afternoon, anonymously, during filming. And Tanya got me my equity card as a reward.
My God.
It was just a job, Dougie. My entrance fee to the world of high living. If it makes you feel any better, I didn't actually touch you, except for the benefit of the photos. Though you won't know that, of course. All you did know was that you had been in bed with me. Tanya had seen the pictures of Mabel had seen the pictures of us. And she flatly refused to see you or speak to you for the remainder of her stay in England. It all went exactly according to plan.
We were going to be married. I bought the ring that very morning.
It was yours, was it? The baby she was expecting when she went to Stratford?
I don't know. It might have been. I didn't know about it till just before she died. We'd only slept together once. It could have been anybody's, somebody she met later on the rebound. I thought maybe I'd driven it, but then last night when he said...
That he'd broken off their engagement when he found out she was pregnant.
That's when I realised he'd done his share to destroy her too. I'd never blamed him before, you see. I'd always thought it was my fault, that it was because of us that she'd had her breakdown at Stratford. But then last night when he said that, everything turned upside down. I didn't know what to think. I can't tell you how I felt. I don't remember anything until he started choking and had his heart attack. For the first time since she died, I felt a great weight lifting off me. But now this, Tanya.
She was a very determined lady. But you never did marry her, did you?
We were engaged for a while, but it's all fizzled out between us when she went over to Hollywood to make a film for Columbia. That's where she met her first and second husbands. When eventually she came back to England, everything had changed. She was a big star and I was just another small-time agent. She bought shares and brought a lot of new people onto the books, lifted me into the major league and allowed me to move across into management. I owed her a lot, looked on her as a friend. Friend. If I'd known what you just told me, I'd slit her throat myself.
Well, that's what I figured. But if you didn't do it, then I'm back to square one. I'm with you, I'd make a lousy detective.
And what if you'd been right? What would you have done? Tried to blackmail me?
I might have done. I'm desperately short of cash. That's why I want this part so badly. But now that's out of the window.
Ron! Where's Ron? What happened? Where is he?
Upstairs. In his room. We put him there last night, remember?
I knew you did. I'm not an idiot. But he's not there now. The room's empty.
We'd better take a look.
I told you he's not there.
I'll check it out.
I thought it was you who moved him. That there was some reason why he
didn't want his body left there. I haven't been near the place since we laid him out last night. This is ridiculous. Why would anybody want to move a corpse? Unless Stella's right.
What about?
She thinks Ron was murdered too.
Of course he wasn't. How could he have been?
Poison in one of his chocolates?
She's out of her mind. I told you last night. He's been having chest pains for months. I wanted him to see a doctor. Do you know what he was? Wouldn't see him. He just wouldn't. That's why he agreed to do the tour. He thought if he immersed himself in work, he'd be able to ignore it all. But the strain was telling on him. His behavior was most peculiar. And then those cuttings started to arrive. Oh, his behavior got worse than ever. It was dreadful. I had no idea why he was acting like that. And of course, he flatly refused to answer any questions. And then, he suddenly takes it into his head to invite everybody down here for the weekend. And the next day, those horrible dogs arrived. That's when I knew something was really wrong. Everything was so out of character. I realize now what a strain he was under. Tanya's murder was the final straw. His heart couldn't take any more.
No.
Oh, if only we could get away from here and contact the police. Do you think some one of us could make it to the house? Mine's parked just round the corner of the house. It wouldn't take many minutes to drive to the village and get help.
If it wasn't for this damn fog, it might be worth taking a chance, but those Dobermans, they could tear you apart before you got to the bottom step, and even if you got to the car, there's still the gates. No, we're better waiting for someone to come to us.
But we've got to do something.
We shall. And the first thing is to find out what's happened to Ron's body.
I hate to add to our problems. We'd better make that two bodies. Target's missing too. There's nothing left in there but a patch of dry blood.
We'd better get the others. Tell them I want them here now. It's a matter of great urgency. Well, that's answered the question regarding Ron's death, hasn't it? I mean, why else would anybody want to move a body except to stop it from being examined?
But that means you think he was murdered.
Yes. Though without a post-mortem, it'll be impossible to prove, and with no body to hand.
No, that's impossible. I cannot accept that. If anyone wanted to harm Ron, why do it here, where suspicion would fall on such a small group of people? Why not wait till we were out on tour, and widening the possibilities?
To begin with, it's my guess that whoever sent those cuttings to Ron expected him to be here alone. If you remember, they started arriving on Monday, but this little gathering of ours wasn't arranged until Thursday afternoon. It's logical to assume that the murderer expected to kill Ron and be miles away with an airtight alibi before anybody discovered the body. And if it wasn't for this fog and Ron's idiotic stunt with the dogs, he or she might have got away with it.
Expected to be here this weekend. None of us anticipated spending a weekend in the country. It was an invitation out of the blue.
I know. Which leads me to believe that Ron had already invited someone down here before he asked the rest of us. The question is, which one of us was it?
It wasn't any of us. The shock of Tanya's murder killed him, not some supposed poison chocolate.
Then, who's moved Ron's body and what's happened to Tanya? I'm sorry, Edith, there's no other logical conclusion I can come to, but right or wrong, we've got to locate them both before the police arrive, for all our sakes.
Well, that shouldn't present any problem. They must be still in the house. No one could get them out, not with those horrible dogs. They were snarling and slathering under my window last night for nearly half an hour.
I know. I heard them myself. Seems to have quieted down now, though. Perhaps they've gone back to their cages.
Perhaps. I wouldn't count on it.
Bradford, you wanted to see us. Is everything all right?
No, it isn't. Someone's entered Rum's bedroom and removed his body.
You're not serious. You don't mean that.
I'm not in the habit of saying things I don't mean, Mr. Bostock. Rom's body is missing, and so is Talia Mason's.
Oh, don't look at me. I haven't touched them.
But why would anyone want to move them?
I think we can hazard a guess, Freddy. But the important thing is to find them both before the police arrive, or all hell is going to break loose.
What's wrong? Has something happened? Somebody's cleared off with the late unlamented.
You
better empty your handbags, darling,
or
would you wait to go and search us all?
Give it a rest, Caroline. This is serious.
What Miss Clavers has just said is right. Rom and Tanya's bodies have both disappeared. Before anyone sits down to breakfast, I want this whole house searched, from top to bottom, attic to cellar. And if anybody's got any objections, I'd like to hear them now. Then we're all agreed?
Sorry to disappoint you, but the last thing I intend doing is tramping about this place looking for missing horses. I'm staying right here.
Where do we start then? Upstairs, downstairs, or in my lady's chamber?
It might be better if we clear off. Lynda and I will take the attics, and you and Edith the bedrooms, Freddy and Stella the cellars.
What about this floor?
We'll cover that when we've done the rest of the clues. Is everyone ready? Right. We'll meet back here as soon as possible.
I'm sorry about what happened last night. You've been marvellous, sir. Perfect piece of casting.
Oh? I didn't realise I had a casting expression on it. How exciting for him. I don't need friends, I need work. And after what's happened here, I'll be lucky if I can buy a ticket at a box office, let alone a train of boards.
You're not the only one, you know. The rest of us aren't going to find it easy either.
I don't care about the rest of you. The only one I'm concerned about is me, Caroline Clavers.
Yes, that's perfectly obvious. Sorry to have kept you, Freddy. I was just trying to...
Yes, Stella.
I was right. He was murdered. I know who did it. I know who killed Tiny and Mom.
What do you mean? You know who killed them?
That starts at the beginning, hasn't I? It was last night, you see, after Mr. Marsh died. Listening to the discussion later on, it seemed perfectly obvious to me that he was the intended victim all along, and that Tiny's murder was just a spur of the moment thing. I spent half the night trying to make sense of it all, but it was no use. Those newspaper cuttings, for instance. Why should anyone start sending them now? It's been 30 years since Mabel Monk killed herself. Then, there was Tiny's conviction that Mabel's mother, sister, or child was right here in the house.
Yes, it does take some believing. But she did go looking for someone. They were quite sure about that.
I know. But Mrs. Bale said Tiny had asked her if she knew where I was. And that didn't make sense to me. I was too young to be Mabel's mother or sister. And even if I was Mabel's daughter, she couldn't have recognised me. She'd never seen a child in her life. No one had. No. If she'd gone looking for anybody, it could only be Mabel's sister. There's no one here old enough to be Mabel's mother, is there? If that was the case, it took me a step nearer to finding out who the murderer was.
How's that?
Simple. Only two people qualified for the position of the sister. Mrs. Bales or Lynda. And I've known Lynda for years. Mrs. Bales gave herself away with a single stupid lie.
But she hadn't. I mean, Tiny was looking for you. I told you last night, remember?
I know. That's what started me wondering if you were lying too.
Me?
Oh, yes. You'd both told the same story, and I was already convinced that Mrs. Bales was lying. Perhaps you're only together. You could be Mabel Monk's son.
What?
Then I remembered something. Something that cleared you. You told us you were in the shower last night when Tiny was looking for me. And when I went past your room after boiling in the switch, I noticed the carpet outside your door was wet. You must have been dripping all over because you spoke to her.
I was, and it wasn't the warmest place I've ever stood, but only a towel wrapped around me.
who was responsible for that? Lynda, of course. My second suspect and self-confessed Mabel worshipper. If Tanya had been looking for me, it could only have been to question me about my involvement with her. Much as I hate to admit it, it now looks as though Lynda had killed her. But I was wrong again. She couldn't have done it. Last time you was upstairs looking for me, Lynda was down here talking with Ron and the others. I felt so frustrated I could have screamed.
Well, that's nothing to the frustration I'm feeling right now. Are you going to tell us to kill the bloody woman, or aren't you?
Actually, it was you who finally put me on the right track.
Me?
Just now. You were standing in exactly the same place as the time it was last night when I walked in wearing that awful gown. I was looking straight at her when the commotion began. No wondering if there was something wrong with her eyes. They didn't seem to be focused on me at all, you see. I've only just realised it. But she hardly noticed me. She was looking at the person on my left, just as you were a few minutes ago when Freddy walked in.
So?
Don't you see? It wasn't me who started Tanya. It was the sight of someone she never expected to see here in a million years. Mabel Monk's sister, Mrs. Bales, the housekeeper.
But you just said... Mrs. Bales.
30 years she blamed Romney Marsh for her sister's suicide, but has been unable to do anything about it. It wasn't until his previous housekeeper retired last year that she was She applied for and got the job of housekeeper to him. And from that day on, he'd been planning to make him pay for what he did. It was incredible bad luck for her that Tiny was on the cast and recognised her. You can imagine how frantic she must have been. Tiny had even opened her mouth, but she'd never have another chance to get near him.
I'm not saying you're wrong, but surely, what if she'd been with him all that time? Why didn't she kill him earlier? She'd had plenty of opportunity.
I don't know. Perhaps yesterday was some kind of appropriate anniversary. Maybe his birthday, or the day she died.
Yes, but even so, if there was a chance Tanya might recognise her, why didn't she get it over with before any of us even arrived?
I think I can answer that. Philip Jordan was the original choice for Lady Millicent. Dougie mentioned it yesterday. But she couldn't do it, and Tanya was brought in as a last-minute replacement. The Bales woman wouldn't have known until she arrived here.
So, as I was saying, if she wanted to continue with her plan, she had no choice but to kill Tanya. I imagine she waited on the landing until she made her way back downstairs again, killed her, and then dragged her body into the next room while we were in here talking. From then on, it all went according to plan. As his housekeeper, she was able to fill one of his chocolates with poison and slip it into the box while we were all eating dinner. It was then just a matter of time before he ate it and died.
Oh my God! I was eating those too! She could have killed me.
But how did she expect to get away with it?
I don't think she did. She only killed Tanya to prevent her giving a warning. Now she's achieved her purpose, I don't think she'll be particularly worried about what happens to her. I've got the distinct impression that having to murder Tanya really upset her.
Oh, I can't take all this in. I thought my dream was some pretty weird characters, but this is all too fantastic for words. I vote we get her in here and see what she has to say for herself.
Well, I'd rather the others be here first.
Okay, I'll go and tell her we're having a meeting and we want her in on it. Then you can keep an eye on her while I fetch the others. Agreed?
Why don't you tell her you're an apology? I know I'm a bitch at times, but you have to protect yourself in this business. Let them see you've got feelings and they'll trample all over you.
Who will?
Them. Management. Everyone else is trying to claw their way up the ladder. Trust none of them, that's my motto.
You sound as though you've had some bad experiences.
Some, but nothing as freaky as this. My agent warned me about Rom and his I am God attitude, but I thought I could handle it. No failing star was going to have me jumping through hoops, I told him. Try his tricks on me and you'd soon see he'd bitten off more than he could chew. Talk about self-delusion. If things hadn't turned out the way they did, I'd even pad in straight jacket and pad itself before opening night. Why nobody tried to bump him off before, I don't know. Can you cook?
Yes.
Good. Then we're not likely to starve to death. I can't boil water without burning it. Well, if you're right about the Bales woman, we can hardly expect her to go on doing the catering, can we? She might slip a dose of rat poison or something in the soup and get rid of us all.
That's not very likely. She's achieved her purpose, and the rest of us won't concern her in the least.
Don't fool yourself. Self-preservation comes high on anybody's list. Once she knows we're on to her, she's not likely to sit around waiting for the police to arrive. We'll have to lock her in her room and fend for ourselves. And speaking of fending, I suppose we'll have to make our own arrangements for breakfast.
Knowing what we know now, I think I'd rather take my chance of a toast and coffee.
What was that?
What?
That noise. As though someone had knocked something over.
I didn't hear anything. Maybe it came from upstairs.
You don't think he's having trouble with her? They should have been back here by now.
It's only been a minute or so.
All the same, I think I'd better go and have a look.
Shall I come with you?
I'll only be a second.
More about that side of things than anybody else I know.
Remember that scene in Forest of Eyes where he changed into the werewolf? He brought one out himself, beginning to end.
Do I ever? Scared the living daylights out of me, and I was in my 20s at the time. That scene where he follows her into the woods and the fog swirling around, look.
Yes, and speaking of fog, looks like it's starting to clear.
He's right. I can see the trees at the edge of the moat. And the edge of the drive.
What about the dog?
Not a sign, but then they could be anywhere. Maybe round the back. This is stupid.
What is?
Well, the way it's lifting. I've never known fog clear this quickly. It's like something out of... Idiot. Why didn't I think of it before? Special effects. Fog machines.
What?
Fog machines. He had studio fog machines built into the house. Flick of a switch and bingo, instant fog.
That's ridiculous.
Is it? Any more ridiculous than doing up this place to look like a House of Usher, complete with fake torture chambers and imitation graveyard? It's all set dressing. Reality wasn't good enough for Ron. He wanted to live in a world of pure fantasy. Well, the man was a genius at what he did. But he'd had a slate loose for years. Who else would fill the moat with damp piranha fish? It must have been costing him a fortune to keep them alive.
On the contrary, for your information, I was right, wasn't I? No power, no fog.
Spot on, Dougie. Now, if only you could switch off those blasted hounds by the same method, we could all slip away quietly into the night and leave the police to sort the whole damn mess out.
We couldn't do that.
Why not? With Rob and his housekeeper both dead. Who's to say we were here at all?
Aren't you forgetting the gatekeeper? He had a list of all the expected guests this weekend, and he couldn't fail to remember your turning up out of the room. Besides, I'm not going anywhere until I know what happened to Ron's body.
Excuse me, I'm not feeling too well.
Freddy!
Need to go into the bathroom.
It's that bang on the head. I knew he needed a doctor. I said so, didn't I?
It's all right, Lynda, I'll take him.
Just dizzy and cold, that's all.
Someone help me to get him upstairs.
God, he's not going to die too, is he?
Of course he isn't. Only concussion, that's all. He'll be fine, given a little warmth and relaxation.
Well, there's some extra blankets on the spare bed in my room. I'll get them.
It's all right, Edith, we'll manage. You stay here with Lynda. I'd rather no one was left on their own from now on.
Just help get the stairs and I'll be all right.
I think I'll make some coffee. Good stiff brand is what I really need. Well, you know where it's kept.
By the way, when you were upstairs with Dougie, did you ever lose sight of him?
Well, maybe for a second or two, but no longer.
Why?
You don't think
no.
He...
No.
I already know who killed Mrs. Beckett and not her, Mr. Boss. I'm just waiting to be sure of my facts before I present my conclusions to the police.
Who is it?
You think about it while I'm making the coffee. You'd be surprised you didn't see it before.
It all fits. But why? Why?
Why what?
The murderer. It was Brad. He's the only one it could have been. Listen, we'll start with those newspaper clippings. Obviously, Mrs. Bales couldn't get up to London on a daily basis to post them. She had to have an accomplice there. And that was Brad.
What was it?
I know, that's what he told us. But it was a lie. He'd never been anywhere near France. He posted the clippings, one each day, leading up to the date when Mrs. Bales would murder Ron with one of his own chocolates. But Ron suddenly invited the rest of us down for the weekend and completely upset their plans. When Mrs. Bales got to know that we were coming, she called Brad and told him. Between them, they decided that he'd let a gate crash the party by pretending he was angling for a pot and make girls look at the murder and try to blame it on one of us. Of course, what they didn't realise was that Tardia had replaced Philippa Jordan as Lady Millicent. And when she recognised Mrs. Bales, they had to kill her too. Then, when Brad found out that you'd realised who Mrs. Bales really was, he had to kill her to stop her from giving him away. It was sheer bad luck that Freddy walked in on him just as he'd done it, but he managed to knock him out with something and get back upstairs to pretend to help Edith look for the missing bodies, you see?
But how did he know if I'd realised who Mrs. Bales was? He wasn't even in the room when I told Freddy to have her.
Maybe he was listening at the door. What does it matter? The thing is, now we know he's a murderer, what are we going to do about it?
Perhaps we'll tell the others.
Of course. The thing that does still puzzle me is what the link is between Brad and Mrs. Bales. I mean, he couldn't have had a thing for them, could he? He's as gay as they come.
It's possible. There are married gays.
Oh, that's true, dear heart. There are black sheep in every family. Who are we talking about, by the way? Anybody I know?
As a matter of fact, Brad, we were talking about you.
My favourite subject. And what were you saying about me? Something flattery, I hope.
Oh, no, Brad, it wasn't flattery. Far from it. We know, you see. We know it was you who killed Tanya and the others.
Oh. I see. And, would it be too inquisitive of me to ask how you were?
Edith told me a few minutes ago.
Ah.
Well, she didn't accuse you outright. She just pointed me in the right direction. It was killing Mrs. Bales that gave you away. You see, Dougie and I were up in the attics when that happened. We never lost sight of each other. Caroline, Stella and Freddie were in here, so that cleared them, leaving only you or Edith as a possible murderer.
Why couldn't Edith be the murderer?
Because when Tanya was killed, Edith was in here with Dougie and Ron. When you came in with blood on your hand, it wasn't from the stairway, as you told me. It was the blood that came from Tanya when you killed her.
But I seem to remember Freddy managed to get some of his hand too.
Well, hardly surprising. You always did pay attention to detail, Brad. When you realised you've got blood on you and didn't have time to change, you smeared it on the stair rail to support the stair controls. It's inevitable that someone else would brush against it.
Well. What a pity you're not an actress and a few years older, then you'd have made a first-rate Miss Mock.
I'm not going to deny it.
No, I don't think so. You seem to have covered all bases, as they say in the States.
But why, Brad? Why did you do it? You're not the murdering type. I've known you for years. Oh, I wouldn't trust you as far as I could throw you in a room full of chorus boys. But murder?
What's it matter? If the police think the same way you do, then it looks like I'm done for. They had me behind bars before you could say bar. Poor old Brad. I suppose you are going to tell the police on this.
I'm sorry, but they'll have come to the same conclusion themselves eventually.
Yes, I suppose they would.
Where are you going?
Oh, nowhere in particular. Very far I can go, have I? I should probably go upstairs. There's something I have to do.
Not wrong, are we?
We're
quite sure it's Brad.
Of course it's Brad. He admitted it, didn't he?
Exactly. He just didn't deny it.
Well, it's the same thing.
Isn't it? Yes. Something I said earlier. I can't remember what it was. I'm sorry, but I'm still not convinced that Brad's the one we're looking for.
But who else could it be?
Edith.
and the evidence of your own eyes. Look at me. When I went upstairs to search with Brad, I was in my night clothes. I went into my room to get changed while he continued searching. He was out of my sight for nearly 10 minutes. Time enough to come down here, kill Mrs. Bales, knock out Mr. Bostock, and then get back upstairs in time to keep me coming out of my room.
The same reason applies to yourself, Edith. In 10 minutes, you were out of his sight.
Well, I washed and dressed in less than 10 minutes, Miss Bickle.
Where's Brad?
I went upstairs.
So I told him to come down here. There's some serious talking to do.
No, there's no need for that now, Dougie. Brad killed Tanya and Mrs. Bates.
What?
He came downstairs while I was dressing, went into the kitchen, killed Mrs. Bales, knocked out Mr. Bostock, and then went back upstairs just in time to meet me coming out of my room.
Are you sure about this, Edith?
There's not a shadow of a doubt. The question is, what are we going to do about him until the police arrive? He will have to be restrained.
I don't know. If you really think Brad is responsible, it might be an idea to get him down here now and face him, at least give him a chance to defend himself.
We've already done that just before you came in.
And what did he say?
He admitted it.
He didn't admit anything. The reason for that is because he didn't do it.
Who did?
No.
But I do.
Really?
I thought you were asleep.
I was, but something woke me. Can you guess what it was, Edith?
How should I know?
The smell of oranges coming from the blankets Dougie threw over me. Blankets borrowed from your room. There was only one person here this weekend who wore an scented perfume, and she's dead. But the person who tried to break in the kitchen was wearing the same. I remember smelling it later. So what was it doing on your blankets?
I have no idea. Freddy.
I'm nearly finished. I managed to haul myself across the landing and make it into her bedroom. Look what I found in your makeup case. L'Orange. Specially created by John Mayer of Paris for Tanya Mason.
I have never seen that bottle before in my life. And how dare you go searching through my things?
Sparring like mad. You shouldn't be on your feet. Here, just have a sit to
me. I'm all right. Really, I am.
Did you hear me? I asked you a question. I demand an apology.
Leave him alone, can't you? You can see his face. And if you ask me, it's you who should be doing the explaining.
There's no explanation necessary.
But I think there isn't. See, none of this is making the slightest bit of sense.
Maybe not to you, but it is to me. It's as clear as daylight. She and the Bales woman were in it together. The Bales woman murdered Tanya. She poisoned Ron, then murdered her partner and tried to frame him, but Tati sent to him the whole thing away.
No, that's not the way it was at all. What I was trying to say earlier is that those blankets didn't come from Edith's room. They came from Stella's.
Right.
That's what I meant when I said none of this made sense. Edith offered her blankets, but when we got Freddy upstairs, it didn't seem worth going all the way down the corridor to get them when Stella's room was next door and there was a spare set in there. So while Brad got him into bed, I went round there and grabbed them.
So how was Tanya's perfume found on Stella's blankets?
I don't know. Maybe she went into my room last night. When she was looking for me.
But even if she had, she'd hardly be spraying perfume about, would she? And you'd have smelt it the minute you walked in.
That's right, and I didn't smell anything.
I couldn't have missed this. It's quite powerful.
And if Stella didn't notice, it must have been sprayed there recently, this morning, to make it appear as though Stella had killed Mrs. Bales and attacked Freddy.
But she couldn't have done. We all know Stella was in here with Caroline when that happened. And how could anyone know Freddy had smelled perfume when he was attacked? I'm the only other one who knew about it. There was no one else here when he told me.
But how did the bottle get into her makeup case?
Well, I should have thought that was perfectly obvious. Someone clearly intended me to take the blame.
For what? It was the sheerest chance that Freddy recognised the perfume and went looking for it. Shouldn't have meant anything to the rest of you.
She's right, unless...
yes. I think I do.
I'll go fetch him.
Yes, who?
I'll tell you when Brad gets down. You may as well make yourselves comfortable. It's a bit involved, and I might tend to wonder a little in my present condition. It was a curfew that gave it away. If it hadn't been for that, the killer might have got away scot-free.
What's that got to do with it?
Nothing, at least, not with the actual murder. It was a red herring, designed to throw us off the scent. Sorry, no pun intended. But I'll explain in a minute.
It's like something out of one of those awful Agatha Christie plays. Everyone gathered in the library to hear the great detective tell them how wonderful he is.
There's nothing of the great detective about me, I'm afraid. I put it all together by trial and error. Most of it we already know. How it all seems to be tied in with Mabel Monk, and how Mrs. Bales appears to have taken the job here simply to get back at Ron for what he did to her sister.
That's ridiculous. Ron did nothing that any other decent man wouldn't have done in the same circumstances.
That as it may, without a body to pull an autopsy on, we'll never find out what killed him. Poison or heart attack.
We're pretty sure to find him, even if we can't. Not that easy to hide a body.
Two bodies, and in this case you're wrong. Usher's the perfect place to dispose of unwanted bodies. Most people would have carp or trout in a moat around the house. What did Ron have?
Oh my god, the piranhas!
Exactly. Ron's eccentricity provided the perfect means to conceal the corpses. I expect if you drag the boat now, you'll find the bones, but not much else.
Where's Brad?
He won't be down. He's killed himself. I found him in his bathroom, the knife still in his hand. Was he the one you... There was no note, but obviously he killed himself rather than face a trial. How did you know?
I suppose I suspected him from the start, really. I never thought of these sort of women, you know, attacks from behind, stabbing people in the back, slitting people's throats. That's the sort of thing I'd expect from a man. When Tanya died, Dougie was here in the room with Edith. So that seemed to indicate Brad had done it. Then there were the missing bodies. Again, I couldn't see a woman having come from very far. Although this time it could have been Brad or you. Later on, though, when Mrs. Bells was murdered and someone tried to crack my skull open, I thought I'd be wrong. After all, what man wears perfume? When I came round, smelling oranges in my nostrils, I suspected Edith, found the perfume in her makeup's place, and I thought the blankets were hers. A few minutes ago, though, I began to see daylight.
Yes?
Well, obviously I can't swear to any of this, but Brad must have overheard my conversation with Lynda, and when I was taken ill, saw a chance to use Tanya's perfume to fray Edith. When he went to go and get the blankets after taking me upstairs, he must have got the perfume out. He got to see Caroline to see if she was okay. He gave the blankets a light dousing of it, and then hid the bottle in Edith's makeup case. When I woke up, I couldn't help but smell it. It'd be easy later on to jog my memory, so I associated it with Mrs. Bell's murderer and my attacker at an opportune moment.
But as it happens, he was too clever for his own murder. The blankets weren't Edith's, they were Stella's. Yet the perfume was still found in Edith's bag.
It was his only mistake.
But what was the connection between him and the Bales woman?
That's something we'll never know. They could have been friends, lovers, anything. But whatever it was, they'd been planning this for a long time. Of course, what neither of them expected was that Ron would have a pack of dogs roaming the grounds to stop anybody leaving. And Brad was trapped here with the rest of us.
But they still went on with their plan.
What else could they do? They'd set it up, and after killing Tanya, they'd no choice in the matter.
It's all so unbelievable.
Well, I don't know about you, but I could do with a drink. Anyone care to join me?
I don't usually indulge so early in the day, but perhaps a small whistle.
I can't tell you what a relief this is. Knowing it's all over and no one can point a finger. The first thing I'm going to do when I get out of here is take a nice long break from Adrian and then start doing the rounds again.
Rubbish.
If anyone wants me, I'll be in my room.
It's no use, Freddy. It's all over. Like a fool, I told you my suspicions about Mrs. Bales. You went into the kitchen, supposedly to bring her back here. Instead, you killed her in the same way that you killed Tanya. Then fake to collapse on yourself by banging your head against the wall or something. That was the thump that Caroline heard. You weren't half as hurt as you made out to be. In fact, from then on, you have to be even more inventive, because now there was a body for the police to examine. You couldn't dispose of that one so easily. You faked a collapse. When Dobby and Brad took you to bed, you took a bottle of perfume, sprayed it onto the blankets that Dobby covered you with, thinking they were Edith, then went into her makeup case to put the bottle.
Why did Brad kill himself?
He didn't. But when we told him that Edith was accused of being the murderer, I believe he thought she was the killer and was trying to frame him. He probably went upstairs to have it out with her, walked in on Freddy arranging his clue, and got himself killed.
But he's in his own room, not Edith's.
I don't doubt it. But I'm sure Freddy found some way of luring him back there before he killed him. That's why he was conspiring so quickly when he came back down. Not because of his so-called concussion.
This is absolute tripe. Probably. Possibly. I think. You can't prove any of it.
I know. But as soon as the police arrive, I'm sure they'll be able to. Forensic science is a marvellous thing. Skin particles, stray hair, speck of dust. It's amazing how much they can give away. And with two bodies to work on, I'm sure they won't have any difficulty in proving that I'm right.
I really underestimated you, didn't I? It should have been your throat I slit.
So, it was you. It was you who killed me. The only man I've ever loved.
Love? What do you know about love? He robbed me of my mother. Oh yes, I'm the one that planned it all. Harriet simply did as I told her. She hastened just as much as I did. But she was too soft for her own good. And she thought Tanya had recognised her. She wanted to call the whole thing off. But I wasn't going to let a little thing like that stop me. Oh no, I slit her throat without a second thought. And I dropped the chocolate suited box when no one was looking. After we dropped the bodies into the moat, I thought we'd be safe. But she started with the detectives and left me with no choice but shut Harriet's mouth too. If it hadn't been for you, I'd have got away with it. What am I talking about? I am getting away with it. Out of my way, I'm leaving. You're not going to try and stop me with that, are you?
Haven't you forgotten something? There's a pack of half-starved dogs roaming around outside. You'll never get to a car.
I wouldn't count on it. You haven't heard much of them since last night, have you? I tossed a few pounds of Dr. Mead down to the Murley this morning. I somehow doubt they're in any fit state to stop me by now. I thought I told you to move. Not you as well. You really wouldn't know how.
Try.
Just for the record, you wouldn't have got away with it, even if you hadn't killed Mrs. Those piranha fish in the boat, they all died during the summer. There's nothing left there now but weeds and a few frogs. The police would have recovered both bodies without any problem.
Well, well, well. We live and learn. It doesn't really matter now, does it? By this time tomorrow, I'll be somewhere across the Atlantic. I booked my flight some days ago.
I don't think so, Freddy. We're going to put you under lock and key. Well, one of us goes to the village to get the police.
I'm sorry to disappoint you, Dougie, but I really can't afford to wait. I'll drop you a postcard.
He's getting away.
I'll cut him off at the gate.
No, wait.
What's happening? Oh my God, the piranha. They're eating him alive.
But you said they were dead.
I know. I lied.
Thank you. he does.
No can do, she said. Anyway, speaking of Pat, of all the people who've worked so hard to put this show on the stage here tonight, Pat Struthers, our director, has worked, and I think we need Pat up here with us now. So Pat, where are you?
Big thank you to them too, and lighting as well in front of the house. Thank you very much.